Otto carried it in on his back and held it up on the back while the worthless guy who put the legs on took forever.
From Arkansas?
All the way from Arkansas. He packed it down here.
He put it in a U-Haul.
He put it in a U-Haul, both of them. This is this one's sister right here. The twins. They go everywhere we go. It's so beautiful having them with us.
Are they both narrow key?
All the time.
Huh? Are they both narrow key?
No, that one's normal. Charles plays that one.
That one's normal, she says. The little books up here are for me to keep track of where I'm at. I had to learn how to sing completely different when I teamed up with Katie because she's a professional and I thought I was. So anyway, her arrangements are so beautiful and everything, and now I actually gotta keep time and sing my note on the beat and all that kind of thing. So sometimes I need a little help. Okay, are we ready? Mom, are you there? Oh, okay. This song comes from the musical South Pacific, right?
No, Breakfast at Tiffany's.
Breakfast at Tiffany's. Breakfast at Tiffany's. You ever see it?
Yeah.
Okay. I didn't hear it. Yeah, it was good. I did see it. It's great. Okay, you all know this one.
What am I playing? I can't remember. Oh, yes. I'm going to play a piano solo now. Can you take this thing off?
No.
And this is from the great Russian composers, Sergei Rachmaninoff. How many have heard of Rachmaninoff? One person, that's it? Only one? Oh my gosh. He's just about my favorite composer. And he was a fantastic composer for piano. So anyway, it's called Prelude in D Major, Opus 23, number 4. Really boring title, but it's a gorgeous piece, very, very romantic. I think of it as a love song. So that I'm gonna just talk a little bit about it to help you hear it. So it presents a beautiful melody three times. This is the melody. Presents it, he has accompaniment notes that go all weave all around the melody. I'll show you. So you see, my hands are kind of tangled. And then the second time he presents the melody, and there's more like a filigree on top of the melody. And then there's some interlude stuff and a big crescendo to a climax like only Rachmaninoff can do. And then he presents the melody again with big chords like this. Register. Rachmaninoff was fascinated by bells. He wrote a whole hour-long choral work called The Bells. And if any of you have ever been to Europe or even, you know, just watch movies, you always hear the church bells. And I lived in Germany for 8 years, so I'm very familiar with the beauty of listening to those big old church bells. So anyway, enjoy this love song. Thank you.
Usually when she plays a song like that, the beginning of the show, the next time I get up to sing, somebody says, how are you gonna top that? I've heard this for months and weeks and weeks. And at first I tried to make excuses like, well, I'm not, you know, she's just, I'm a singer, she's a pianist, but finally I just realized it can't be done. So I try to detach myself from it and move on. Hey, you'd be surprised. Top that one. Kyle, can you do anything that good? No. All right, what's up next, huh?
Elvis.
Oh, yes.
Now we're talking.
We're gonna do a little Elvis. Okay. Now, I can sound like Elvis if I want to, but I kind of try to get away from that because, you know, it's about being my own personal person, empowering myself, not copying someone else, seeing if I can sing it my way just as good as him. And so it's gonna be a kind of a fluctuation between the two. Okay, here we go. Elvis Presley. Everybody knows this one.
Falling.
Song at a different time. Okay, next one we're going to do. Oh, yes, we're going to do a Neil Diamond song. Anybody like Neil Diamond?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Ah, oh, crafty noser, get on board. And we're going to ride till there ain't no more to go. Taking it slow, and love, don't you know? A happier time with a poor man's lady pitching on a twilight train. Ain't nothing here that I care to take along. Maybe a song, sing what I want. No need to say please, single man, for a happy tune. You're a stalwart woman. You make me sing like a guitar. And hang on to me, girl. The song keeps running on. Play it now, play it now, play it now, my baby. Crackling rosy, make me smile. And girl, if it lasts for an hour, that's alright, as we got all night. We'll set the world right. We'll find us a dream that don't ask no questions, yeah. Oh, I love my rosy charm. You got the way to make me happy. You and me, we go in style. Crackling rose, you're a star-bought woman. You make me sing like a guitar humming. Hang on to me, girl, the sun keeps running on. Play it now, play it now, play it now, my baby. Crackling rose, you make me smile. And girl, if it lasts for an hour, that's alright, cause we got all night. We'll set that world right. Find us a dream that don't ask no questions, yeah. Find us a dream that don't ask no questions, yeah. That was fun. You know, song from an artist I kind of know how to sing. It's kind of brings me back to the old days. Right, Mom? Are you out there, Mom?
Yeah, you can
do tomorrow. Okay, all right. All right. Now we turn it over to the master of the keyboard.
That's right. You know who I am, and you know who you are.
So I'm going to play a very famous piece by Beethoven. And I think most people would know. It's the first movement of the Moonlight Sonata. It's this one. People know that one. I've heard it. One, two, three, a few, four. Okay. So I'm going to talk a little bit about it, of course. So Beethoven, greatest composer of all time, greatest pianist. And when was he born? 1770, died in 1827 at the age of 57. He went deaf by the time he was 30. Considered suicide because, as a musician going deaf, he thought that was the end of everything. But he discovered that he heard music in his head. And his greatest compositions were composed when he was deaf, like his famous Ninth Symphony with a chorus. So he was not of the aristocracy, not of the upper class. But because he was so famous in his time and popular, he taught piano lessons to the daughters of the aristocracy. And the older daughters, he kept falling in love with them. And there was one in particular named Countess Julia, and he just fell head over heels in love with her and taught her piano lessons. And her husband had passed away, and she had three children. And one day he actually proposed marriage to her, which just wasn't done. You know, the lower classes didn't propose marriage to the higher classes. So she gently declined his offer. And it just really, really broke his heart. That was one of the biggest heartbreaks in his whole life. And he wrote this and dedicated it to her. And actually, it sounds like a funeral march. That rhythm, ba, 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 that's a funeral march rhythm. You might know this one. Something like a towel to put this on. Are you there?
What?
I need a towel to put this on or a washcloth or something. It's just gonna roll onto the floor. Anyway, funeral march. Do you know this one? That's pretty famous, isn't it? Everybody know that one? Do you know who wrote it? Chopin. That's from his B-flat minor sonata. But anyway, there's that with the bum, ba-bum, ba-bum. So my opinion is that he wrote this as a funeral march to his love for Julia, for the Countess Julia, now that she was dead. So it's a beautiful melody. And there's one part in the middle where what he wrote is this. Triplet notes, da da da, triplet, triplet, triplet. But he wrote, the first part of the triplet is written as a quarter note, which means you bring it out. So now it sounds more like this. Those are like his teardrops falling because he's so sad over Julia. And then there's another part. Let's see. Where is that? Where you're going to hear a real clash. So that's about as clashy as you can get. An expression of the pain, the incredible pain he was going through.
And then Beethoven was famous for going into these raptures. His friend would say, Beethoven, come back, where'd you go? Because he would just kind of space out and not really be there. And then he'd come back and he'd write something amazing. But he kind of did that in his music a lot too, where all of a sudden, instead of the melody that you were hearing, it just goes off into this kind of crazy stuff. So it does it here. And it just kind of meanders for a little while, and then it comes down and you hear a couple of big teardrops, and then the melody comes back again. So just a few interesting points about the piece.
Thank you.
question. How do you suppose someone composes such a song? I mean, do they hear it in their head first?
You know, or they compose composers it? Composers like Beethoven and Mozart, they just heard it. And when it came down to write it out, it was already done. It was amazing. They said Mozart, for instance, would be at parties and he'd be scribbling on a napkin as he was talking to people, because it was already there and he was just writing it down like dictation. I don't understand a mind on that kind of genius level.
Voices,
really,
I hear all the time.
Huh?
What'd
you say?
You
burn things down.
Yeah, things are voices in your head.
Thought I was the only one that heard them.
No. We've all heard them. And I think they all say the same thing to all of us. Go ahead. Just try it once. I don't know what I'm saying. All right.
Frank Sinatra.
A little Frankie.
Oh, my God.
Dale. Come on.
I thought he was going to rub off on him a little bit. What happened?
Are you ready?
Spring is like on Jupiter and Mars. In other words, my hand. In other words, baby, kiss me. Fill my heart with song and let me sing forevermore. All I worship and adore. In other words, please be true. In other words, I love you. Spit it out, kid. Sometimes, if your way, if it's the Lord's way, should be your way, shouldn't it? So I sing this song with that in mind. My way. All right. Are we ready? You know, a lot of guys did this. I mean, all the major stars did this. Elvis did this. Frankie did it. And it actually comes from a
musical.
A musical.
Yeah, I forget which one.
From way back, yeah. A European one. No? Okay, all right. Okay, here we go. My way. I will. And now, the end is near. So I face the final curtain. My friends, I'll say it clear. I'll state my case, of which I'm certain. I lived a life that's full. I've traveled each and every highway and more. Much more than this, I did it my way. Yes, there were times I'm sure you knew, but then again, what I had to do. I planned each charted course, each careful step along my way. And much more than this, I did it my way. Yes, there were times I'm sure you knew. When I bit off more than I could chew, and through it all, when there was doubt, I ate it up and spit it out. I faced it all, and I stood tall, and did it my cries. I've had my fill, my share of losing, and now as tears subside, I find it all so amusing. To think I did all that, and may I say, not in a shy way. Oh no, not me. I did it my way. For what is a man? What has he got? If not himself, then he has not to say the things he truly feels, and not the words of one who needs. The record shows I took the blows and did it my way. Yeah, see those teeth. Of course, you know, you do this, anyway, you know, when you do your own thing ever, whatever it may be, and you're out there and someone goes, oh, nice job. And you're sitting there and you're thinking, oh, that was terrible. You ever done that? No. Come on, I'm not the only one, right? I'm not the only one that stands up here and goes, I could have done that better.
Doing
that. But I thought I did a good job.
Yeah.
Did you like it?
Yeah.
Dale,
yeah.
Was it okay?
Yeah.
Okay, excellent. All right, we're going to turn this over to Catherine.
Don't give me that look. What time?
So I'm going to play a piano solo. I don't think it's on.
Push the little button. It lights up green.
So this is a song written by Robert Schumann, one of the great romantic composers. And in classical music, we divide it into these periods, of which the classical period is actually just one period. It kind of starts back. Classical music really started with Pope Gregory back in the 1200s. And he was the first one to start writing little circles with sticks, you know, to mean notes on paper, which made, you know, Beethoven's Ninth Symphony possible. Without writing music down and having musicians read it, you couldn't have an orchestra. Who's not listening to me back there?
Dale. Me and your mother.
Yeah. Dale.
Go outside.
They're composing a song.
Are you ready?
Yes.
So anyway, first around the time of, say, Romeo and Juliet, that would be called the Renaissance. Then came the Baroque period with, for instance, Johann Sebastian Bach, Handel's Messiah. You all know that, I think, the Hallelujah Chorus. And then after that came the classical period, which was Mozart. And then and that's when the piano was invented. And then came the Romantic period, when people started realizing the potential of all these 88 keys, and they started using the whole thing and getting really virtuosic. So Schumann was one of those composers. However, this was a song he wrote for his fiancée. And Robert Schumann was a very talented piano player, and he decided when he was 18 years old that he wanted to be a concert pianist. So first he sought out the greatest piano teacher in Germany, where he was born. And that was a man named Herr Wieck. He's also called Papa Wieck. Papa Wieck had a daughter, Clara, who was 13 years old, and he had trained her in piano, and she was already like a worldwide star. She traveled all over Europe playing for the kings and queens and all that. Papa Wieck was actually quite abusive. He started her on piano when she was 2 years old, and she had to practice 2 hours a day, and then later 6 hours a day. 2 hours a day piano practice when you're two? That's crazy. Even I wouldn't do that. But anyway, so Robert moved in, and he and Clara promptly fell in love. They had to keep it secret. And Robert was concerned about his hands because he couldn't reach as far as he wanted to, because big hands really make a difference when you're playing piano. So one night he put a device on his fingers to cut the webbing in between the fingers so that he could stretch farther, and he left it on overnight. And the next morning when he woke up, his right hand was permanently crippled. So bad for Schumann and his piano career, but good for us because he turned to composing and he left us a wealth of incredibly beautiful music. So anyway, his and Clara's romance is like one of the biggest topics of the 1800s amongst musicians. And they had to keep their love affair secret because Papa V didn't want her marrying some unknown musician. She was destined for greater things. Besides, she was his cash cow. And so they wrote each other secret letters, and finally he wrote music, spelling out with the keys, you know, A, B, C, D, F, G, H, spelling out messages to her so she could just read the music and know what the message was. Anyway, when Clara was 21, they actually all went to court. They took Papa Wieck to court, and the judge said, well, Clara's 21, she can do what she wants. So she married Schumann, and they had 8 children, and then he went crazy and committed suicide. And she hit the concert scene again to take care of her children. I'll tell you one anecdote about her, her 8 children. But anyway, she was, in those days, you played in the castles of the aristocracy. And musicians were considered lower class, you know, they were the lowly entertainment. And so you'd have a party going on and people would be talking and laughing and the poor musicians would be trying to play, not Clara. People were talking, the aristocracy were talking and blabbing while she was playing, and she stopped playing and she said, either you talk or I play. And they got quiet. But that was pretty outrageous for her. Anyway, so he wrote this as a song. It's based on a beautiful romantic poem by a German composer, and it starts with, you are my heart, you are my soul. And it goes, it's a beautiful, very, very romantic poem. And anyway, the great pianist Franz Liszt, who was friends with Schumann and Clara, took that song then and made a solo piano version of it. So as I like to say, now we pianists can play this beautiful song without that pesky singer.
Yeah, I heard it.
So the basic melody. That's you are my heart, you are my soul. Three times with a little intermediary thing. And then at the end there's a quote of Schubert's Ave Maria. And back in those days, when a man was courting a woman, he was very chivalrous and he wrote her poetry and serenaded her under her window and romantic things like that. And it was like the highest compliment to compare your sweetheart to the Virgin Mary. And so that's why he put that at the end of the song. But nowadays, so anyone in those days would have understood why he put that at the end of the song. But these days I have to explain it. Anyway, enjoy.
Thank you.
tried composing? Would it be
it? I've done some composing. It's not my big talent, but I've done actually quite a lot of composing. More arranging. I like to arrange folk songs. I have a Celtic band. I arranged a whole bunch of Irish music for them, and I do some of the arrangements with them.
I guess it's...
So what's the difference between composing and arrangements?
What's the difference?
Yeah.
Well, you know, it is something that happened really only in the classical music genre. And I think it was because there were so many great composers in the 1800s that wrote just incredible music for all the instruments, that in order to play this repertoire, you had to specialize. You had to specialize in just learning and playing the repertoire. And so I was never taught composition. I was just taught to play piano. So in the old days, everybody composed and played their own music. But then when all this great music came, then started this specialization. And I always think it's a little unnatural, you know, to be able to play your instrument so well, but not know anything about composing and not compose. But that's what happened as a result of all this great music. Musicians just became specialized.
There you have it, there it is.
Your turn.
Well, it's kind of like a Rubik's Cube. It's confusing. That little thing is confusing.
Let's see here. All right, a little Eagles.
Yes. We're going to do a little Eagles song. This is a very, very famous ballad, also covered by about every artist in the world. And so, but it's one of my favorites, so we threw it on the show.
What?
Desperado, why don't you come to your senses? Come down from your fences for so long now. Oh, you're a hard one. I know that you've got your reasons. These things that are pleasing you hurt you somehow. Don't you draw the queen of diamonds, boy? She beats you, she's able. You know the queen of hearts is always your best bet. To me, some fine things have been laid upon your table, but you only want the ones you can get. Desperado, oh, you ain't getting no younger. Your pain and your hunger, they're driving you home. And freedom, oh, freedom. Well, that's just some people talking. Your prisoner's walking through this world alone. Don't your feet get cold in the wintertime? Sky won't snow and the sun won't shine. It's hard to take it the nighttime from the day. You're losing all your highs and lows. Ain't it funny how the feeling goes away? Desperado, why don't you come to your senses? Come down from your fences. Open the gate. Maybe raining, but there's a rainbow above you. You better let somebody love you. Let somebody love you. You better let somebody love you before it's too. Again.
Where's my lighter?
Okay, now this one coming up is probably, I think, it's got to be easily in the top 10 of the greatest songs ever written. Ever. And if you're all my age, which some of you are, some of you are younger, some of you are majestically and dignified and wondrously a year or two older than me, and that's great. I look forward to the experience and wisdom I'm going to gain in the next 2 years when I catch up with you. Anyway, whew, boy, I danced around that one nicely. This is a great song, and if you don't agree with me it's one of the greatest songs ever, then we're just never going to be on the same page about music ever. Okay, ready? Let's do it.
Like a bridge.
One of the best 10 songs of all time? Come on, top 20?
Yes.
Okay. What kind of people are we?
We know more songs.
Okay, this is my last piano solo, and then we've got two songs left, and that'll conclude the program. And this is Chuck's favorite piece, isn't it?
Just depends.
Depends on how well you play it.
No, I'm just kidding. Yeah, it is. I love this piece.
So this is by Franz Liszt, and he's the one who arranged the Schumann song into a piano solo. And he was born in 1811 in Hungary. And he was also just a phenomenal child prodigy. And his dad also took him all over Europe playing for the kings and queens and whatnot and making lots of money off the kid. And when Liszt was 15, his father died. And he kept playing concerts for another 5 years to support his mother. And then he was just sick and tired, I don't blame him. I mean, from as a kid, touring, playing piano all over the place. He was just sick and tired of the piano and playing, so he ran off to Switzerland with a beautiful married countess. And they hung out there for a couple of years. She was very selfish. She wanted Liszt all to herself. And he was an extremely handsome man and so magnetic that he was called, in those days, he was called the original rock star. Women would literally scream, stand up, and faint when he walked on stage. And they'd throw flowers up on stage, or they'd throw their hotel key, or they'd run after him and do things like pick up a used cigarette that he smoked on and then encase it in gold and turn it into a necklace. I mean, they were nuts. They were nuts about this guy. And he was an absolutely phenomenal, phenomenal pianist. Except for Beethoven, he was the greatest of all time. So anyway, there he was in Switzerland, and he heard through the grapevine that European audiences were saying, well, we don't need Franz Liszt anymore because we have Sigismund Thalberg. So this new guy had come on the scene and he was a sensation. And Thalberg was called the three-handed pianist because he had a technique of composing where both hands would be doing arpeggios, which are also called broken chords, are these things. So they'd be doing that in both hands, up and down the piano, and somehow mysteriously out of the middle of the keyboard, a melody would arise. And they said, what hand is playing that melody? He must have three hands. And actually the secret was in the thumbs, because as the right hand would come to the middle of the keyboard, the thumb would strike a note, and then the left hand thumb would strike a note, right hand. And so that way this melody emerged, and they couldn't see how he was doing it. Well, Liszt was not happy to find out he'd been deposed as the king of piano, so he hot-footed it back to Europe and had a number of piano duels with Thalberg, and he won. He asserted himself as the king. And for these duels, he composed a piece. He said, you know, well, I can do that three-handed thing too, and I can do it better. So he composed this piece. It's called Un Sospiro, which is Italian. It means a sigh. And it has all the flashy stuff in it. It has arpeggios, hand over hand, big octaves, fast, runny passages. And two times in there, it has the two-handed thing. So I'm just gonna show you a few things. The melody is really simple. That's the whole melody. You're gonna hear it a lot. And then one time, a number of times, he brings the melody straight up. And for Liszt, that always had a religious connotation, because in spite of his extreme womanizing, which he did his whole life, he was a very religious man, and in later years became a deacon in the Catholic Church. And his friends said, oh, Liszt, he's just such a dramatic man and such a show-off. He just did it so he could wear the black cassock, and we have to call him Father Liszt now. But actually, from the day he took orders, he got up at 5 o'clock every morning and went to Mass and never missed a day for the rest of his life, so I think he was serious. Anyway, let's see. Oh yeah. So in the beginning, the melody is split between the hands. And both hands are also playing the arpeggio accompaniment. I'll show you how that works. little demonstration. It's about 7 minutes long.
Thank you.
I agree with Chuck. That's your wild number.
You should see her do Rhapsody in Blue. All 15 minutes of it. It's amazing. One of these days.
Maybe next time.
The next song that we're going to do, we always, in our show, we take the second to the last song and we dedicate it to our Father in Heaven, who has made all of this for Katie and I possible and joyful and wonderful. And so in this particular show, we decided that we would take a song written and composed by Neil Diamond off of his Jonathan Livingston Seagull album. Any of you ever listened to that?
No.
Never have? Oh, it's wonderful. Anyway, this song is called Dear Father, and it's very short as far as lyrics go. There's not a whole lot of lyric in the song, but the words are few, but they're very meaningful. And they talk about the questions, I think, that we all have, and how all we always know that our Father is with us. Katie put a beautiful arrangement of this together, and it's an honor to sing it tonight with you, and I will sing it as a prayer, and I hope you will join me in feeling the Lord's presence with us this evening.
Thank you.
you. Here we are. Last song of the evening. So we're going to do something exciting on the last song of the evening.
Elvis.
No, this is more exciting than Elvis.
Eagles.
This song is called Granada. Do you know the song Granada? No. Oh, come on. Okay. All right. You are going to learn Granada tonight. And you're going to like it because it is a great song.
It's a Spanish flavored Latin American pop song.
All the great guys sang it, except I can't find it. It's in alphabetical order, isn't it? That's why I can't find it.
Looks like you have to do silver bells.
Okay. All right. This song is a personal challenge to me. I love this song because when I first started singing it, there's no way I could have sang this song. So I've been working with Katie over the last couple, 3 years, and I finally decided I'm going to take it on and I'm going to sing it. So, here we go, Granada.
Granada is again the glory of yesterday.
it, I guess.
Yeah, that's all, folks.
Oh, you didn't say anything about the desserts.
We already ate desserts.
Oh. Wasn't that cake gorgeous?
Yes. Yeah.
Let's give a round of applause to Rhonda.
Yeah, another cake. Encore on the cake right now.
Go make another
one. Go make another one.
We've got more cupcakes in there.
Oh. We get two.
Yeah, thank you.
And also, you guys saw the little things about, we thought we'd like do a little Christmas thing here in a couple weeks.
Oh, yeah.
And it's just going to be potluck type thing. Everybody comes, everybody has a good time. And we want to make sure that... We'll have some songs we're going to sing for you and stuff, but basically it's just a get-together. Let's get together and have some fun together in this beautiful spot. And music, of course. You'll all be expected to sing. So, right, Dale's going to practice up his fool game because, you know.
The challenge is on.
The challenge is on. You got to beat the old guy again. Hey, it isn't easy. I try, you know. Once in a while he lets me win. Because he's kind. But he keeps telling me, you're getting better now, we're getting away, we're back to the rules, regulations.
Yeah, yeah.
No cheating. So. Okay, so you might want to look that over and keep in touch with us, give us a call and see if you guys can make it out. We'd really enjoy it. I think we're going to have a beautiful, wonderful time. So thank you again for being here tonight.
Thank you.
The middle part of
it was his stuff.
Yeah. I picked some of what I was thinking. I definitely heard it.
Yeah. I just think I have. Right? Okay. Get about Blue Mount Rawhide. Rawhide?
Well, thanks for coming.
Enjoyed it. Cross out.
Oh, sure. Yeah, you bet. You bet.
I remember one time when she got the money of the red. And the red bastard. Obviously, she was quiet. She was a quiet one. That was the noisy one.
You're going back to Gordon?
To Rushville, yeah. Yeah, I don't know. I saw pretty in the shower.
Yeah.
I wasn't quiet, but it wasn't
hot. Oh my God, but I can see my hair. Yeah.
I was not. I had to be.
Yeah, I think
that's right.
I was not.
I had to be. I had to be. I was trained to be.
I'm sure I am.
Yeah, believe it, I'm in. But then, of course, then I had, you know, mentors come into my life, like your sister. Came in and taught me how to really be more.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Me too. I love that cold weather.
Yeah.
Amazing. Well, I'm going to go out and I'm going to have a little puff on the cigar. And I'm going to change my shirt.
See you guys.
Yeah. Damn, but this is Dale thinks it is.
Well, the kid can sing.
You get any pictures today? You get a picture of me when it's happy, sitting on my lap. It was good.
And you filled out the
thing for the
okay. Yeah. It's not off by you.
You know where I am.